Well, happy, good, well, I guess it's not a good, it's not a happy Friday. It's a sad Friday. I was just saying that earlier, that of all of the Holy Week, Friday is the most sad day of the whole week, isn't it? Let's watch, we watched this video last week, but I want you to listen to the words of the Via Dolorosa. Good Friday. Wow. I guess why would you call it Good Friday when Christ went through that? But Christians all recognize this day that Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross and bled for each one of us, just like that song said. Sunday's Easter, though, that's the day of the resurrection. But today is the day that he bled and he died and he was scorned and the crown of thorns put on his head and drugged through there. As I was, Wayne and I were putting together the cross this week, we put it together and it's made out of 4x4s, and I'm sure the cross that Jesus had to carry down the Via Dolorosa was a lot heavier than this one was, and we were walking across the floor with that and thinking about what Jesus must have gone through. Wow. Wow. But it's a day that we remember the sacrifice that God did. He sent his only begotten Son to die and to bleed for each one of us. Amen. Let's sing the song, Room at the Cross.
He was crushed for our iniquities.
The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Thus be the word of God. Thank you. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, this day is Good Friday. We remember how Jesus Christ came to earth as the Son of God and was convicted for no crime at all. He was tried, convicted, beaten, bruised, humiliated, and stripped of his garments, crown of thorns pushed upon his head. He was forced to carry his own cross down the road of the Via Dolorosa to the hill where they nailed him to that same old cross. Lord, while this does seem a tragedy, yet Jesus took my sins to the cross and gave me freedom and a hope of eternal life with him. Thank you, God. Dear Heavenly Father, help us today to evaluate our own life and see if there be any fault in us. If we have any trials or temptations or anything today, Lord, help us to take them to the cross and leave them there tonight and not carry them around. Lord, help us to realize this saddened day will be the victory in just 3 days, Lord. Thank you, God. Jesus Christ rose from the dead and lives within us today. Help us, God, to remember that tonight, that Jesus did what he did for us and for me. Amen. Steve's going to come up and read some scripture.
From the 27th chapter of Matthew, Jesus dies on the cross. Now, from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which is my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of those who stood there when they heard that said, this man is calling for Elijah. Immediately one of them ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed, and offered it to him to drink. The rest said, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come to save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice, and yielded up his spirit. Then, behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So when the centurion, those with him who were guarding Jesus, saw the earthquake and the things that had happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. So ends the reading.
Would you have liked to have been there that day? I would have been scared too, I think, of all that was going on that day. Wow. The Lamb. The cross of Christ is the only place where lost sinners can find their way home. Amen? As I mentioned earlier tonight, as we go through the sermon this evening, if there's anything that you may have on your heart that you just want to leave on the cross tonight and just go home free of it and know that God will take care of that, write it down on that card and we'll come up later and nail that to the cross. I don't know about you, but this last week has been a tough time for Linda and myself as we went to Colorado, not only the weather, But it was a tough time to meet with family that had lost a loved one through a tragic mishap. And yet it seemed like to me that was a trial that Dolores had to go through in order to maybe draw her closer to the Lord. Tonight we're going to be talking about what Jesus went through as he was nailed to the cross. Easter is all about the crucifixion, the sad time in which Jesus had to go through for you and for me. He took all of our sins and took them to the cross with him. Today we see crosses all over. We see them in churches. We see them at the mortuaries. We see them at hospitals. We see them at schools sometimes, if they haven't taken them out. We see them alongside the road. I can't name, tell you how many we saw as we were driving from here to Colorado and back, all the crosses on the side of the road. What do those crosses mean? What do those crosses mean? They're paying respect and maybe they're looking for hope. The cross brings us hope tonight, doesn't it? The hope of eternal life with Jesus Christ. It gives us that hope. And it's always been, the cross has always been about the hope. Strange thing was that Jesus had to go through that and die on the cross a miserable death so that we could be free. Wow. Tonight we're going to talk about the Lamb that Jesus represented, the Lamb of God. There were two British scientists that did a lot of study on this, a lot of research, and he concluded that Jesus died on Friday, April the 3rd, 33 AD. Now I'm just going to read this to you because this is what was written about this. So Colin Humphreys and W.J. Waddington of Oxford published their findings in the British Science magazine, and their combined study of the Gospels and the scientific records lead them to this conclusion today. It said all four of the Gospels agree that Jesus died just a few hours before the start of the Jewish Sabbath, which was at the nightfall on Friday. They also agreed that it was the Passover, which was the annual Jewish feast at the full moon. The lambs were killed between 3 and 5 p.m. on the 14th day of the Jewish month of Nisan, which corresponds to our March or April. Jesus was on the cross from 9 o'clock in the morning till 3 in the afternoon. And so he died just as the Passover lambs were dying. He was the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And as Paul said in 1 Corinthians, for Christ, our Passover lamb was sacrificed for each one of us. His timing was kind of unique, that timing of his death. Because if you look back at the time of Jesus' birth, it came in the fullness of the time that God had sent forth. Look at the two times and they kind of correspond to each other. But now on the cross, it's precisely the fullness of Jesus that he died. This is the time that the sacrificial lambs were killed. Now if we look at the scriptures, we read that Jesus Christ was the Passover lamb. The Passover lamb. He was identified as a lamb. Jesus didn't come to be the strong lion or any of the strong things that the Jews were looking for at that time. They were looking for a savior that was going to come riding in on a horse and conquer the Romans, right? They were going to conquer the Romans, yet that's not the way Jesus came in. He came in as a lamb and was sacrificed as a lamb. And he did that voluntarily. Now, I don't know about lambs. I've never been on a farm. Most of you have. You've probably been on a farm and raised lambs, sheep, cows, whatever. But I understand that a lamb will die without a fight. You just bring them up to the slaughter and they just stand there and they die. They meekly go to their death. That's what Jesus Christ did. He voluntarily laid down his life for you and for me. No fighting there. Jesus could have called, as the song goes, Jesus could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and for me. Isaiah says he was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opens not his mouth. He did not say a word. He just died voluntarily for each one of us and took the sins on of each one of us. And we also read in that scripture that the veil was ripped in two, because before that, everyone had to go through and have the priest go into the holy place. You couldn't go in and take your cares and your trials and things you were going through. You couldn't take them to Jesus alone. You had to go through a priest. That veil was torn in half. Now, this wasn't probably, that veil was probably a lot sturdier than our curtains that we have up here. Yet, during the earthquake, they were ripped totally in half. I think I would have been scared if that happened, to see all that happen. Isaac Watts in the 1700s wrote a song that says, "Not all the blood of beasts on Jesus' altar slain could give the guilty conscience peace or wash away the stain. But Christ the heavenly Lamb takes all our sins away, a sacrifice of nobler name and richer blood than they." Wow. And also we read that Jesus Christ was worthy. He was the worthy Lamb. Worthy Lamb. In Revelation 5, it says, "Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?'" Who is worthy? "And behold, and lo, in the midst of the throne stood a lamb as it was slain," Jesus Christ. "And all the other beings fell down and worshiped the Lamb." Wow. They fell down and worshiped the Lamb. And the scripture continues and says, "They sang a new song saying, 'You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals, because you were slain, and with the blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation.'" He did that for every one of us. From when he died until us, and even past our generation, Jesus Christ died for us. Wow, the sacrificial lamb was worthy. The only one that was worthy. And then the scripture continues on. It says, "Then millions of angels joined in loud voices singing, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise.'" Did you hear that again? "Worthy is the Lamb to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." We need to give the Lord praise today, don't we? Amen? Even on this night, which we're not used to coming out this late at night, we need to give God the praise and the glory. And it continues in verse 13. It says, "Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that was in them saying, 'To whom who sits, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, to be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever and ever and ever.'" Wow. The four creatures that were there said, "Amen," and the elders fell down and worshiped him. When's the last time you fell down and worshiped the Lord? When have you done that? There's a poet that also wrote, says, "The whole creation joined in one to bless the sacred name of him who sits upon the throne and to adore the Lamb." Wow. During this time, we sing a lot of songs of praising God, Hosanna, and crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon the throne. Hark, how the heavenly angels sang. Wow. But on Good Friday was the day that Jesus Christ actually shed his blood for us. A solemn day. And if that was all we were looking forward to was Good Friday, wouldn't it be a life without hope? That's what a lot of other religions out there today, they had their prophet preaching to them and raising them up, and people were praising and worshiping them, and they died. They're left there. Their bones are still in the grave. Jesus Christ arose from the dead. Amen? Wow. And then we noticed in the scripture, it says the skies were darkened. The skies were darkened. It says from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came all over the land. Now I hear in Alaska that it stays dark an awfully long time and it's very depressing. But if you're not used to that, and all of a sudden it's dark for 3 hours, and you don't know what's going on, and there's an earthquake, and the veil rips in two, and all of a sudden it's dark, I think I'd be a little bit scared. Yet what happened at that particular time? From noon to three, everything went dark. What does that symbolize? What happened that God made the whole earth dark? Jesus Christ took the sins of all of us upon himself. And God could not look at sin. We can't live in sin and have Jesus Christ in our life all at the same time. Because it's a dark, dark time if we are trying to do that. God could not look upon Jesus because all the sins of all people, all colors, all tribes, it says, everyone. He took all the sin upon himself, and God could not look upon him. And for 3 hours, it was pitch black. Amos prophesied that back in the Old Testament. He said, in that day, declares the sovereign Lord, I will make the sun go dark at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. Amos predicted that way back when, prophesied about it. Remember back when Moses was dealing with all the different plagues, and remember one of them was it became dark for 3 days. You think there's a correlation between three around here? He made it dark. God made it dark for 3 days to scare them into letting the people go. In Joel, it also says a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness. Darkness. If you have sin in your life today, it's a dark, dark time in your life. Dark time. You know, as I was doing that memorial service last week, I looked out and saw blank stares as I was trying to present the gospel to these folks, and I didn't know anything about their life, and yet it looked to me like they were searching for something because of the look in their eyes as they were looking at me. It's a sad day, a dark day, if you have sin in your life. Then we have the cross. The Lamb was put on the cross. The Lamb of the cross represents the anger of all mankind. The Romans put Jesus Christ on the cross. That was the worst possible way to put him to death, was on the cross. And they also hung whatever his crime was. Well, Pilate couldn't find a crime, but he had to put some sign up there, and he said, King of Kings. He didn't know how right he was, right? He didn't know how true he was, what truth he was saying. We put things on the cross. The anger that we have is on the cross. That's a battle that we go through all the time. We think we carry that whole heavy cross. If we are carrying guilt and sin in your life today, or something's going on in your life today, you need to give it to the Lord and let Him carry the cross for you. Get that cross, that heavy cross off of your shoulders. Good Friday is certainly not a celebration for a Christian. Good Friday isn't. But in fact, the day to remember is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen?
Amen. Amen.
The whole world of sinners looked at God and saw Jesus Christ on the cross. In Acts 9, chapter 4, it gives the story of Saul. And remember, he was walking down the road to Damascus, and he was struck and blind. Remember that story? And God called out to Saul and says, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Why do you persecute me?" And remember the last words that Jesus spoke on the cross? My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Wouldn't that be a horrible, horrible life to think that God had forsaken you? But thanks to Jesus Christ and His resurrection, the victory was won. We're not there yet. We've got to wait till Sunday. But victory is coming because of what Jesus Christ did on that cross. The Lamb of God that was sacrificed for each one of us. Tonight we're going to bring up, in just a minute, we're going to bring up our cards that we have something written on. And you will not need to show it to anybody. This is between you and God. Bring that card up and nail it to the cross, never to have that trial again. God will handle anything that you bring His way. Put it on the cross and leave it there. Don't come back. Satan would love you to just say, "Okay, I've nailed it up there, but I'm gonna take it off there and bring it back. And I'm gonna look at it again because it's still real in my life." Don't let it tear you down, no matter what's going through in your life. Don't let any of those trials and temptations and things that you have tear you down as a person. Bring it to the cross. Let God handle it. As we come up tonight, what I'd like you to do is come up and bring your card, grab a nail, there's a hammer there, and just nail that sucker to the cross, to leave it there. Okay? And when you get through, there'll be a couple of guys up here helping. As you get through, we'll take a cup for communion and take that back to your chair, and we'll have communion when everybody's finished putting their things, their cards on the cross. Okay? Bless you all. It's so neat to be back. You stand with me. You may start anytime. Spikes being hammered into the cross. Spikes into the cross. your trials, your heartaches, your temptations, anything that you have going on, you just left them there. Don't worry about them ever again. Don't even think about them. You've given it to the Lord. Amen? I know it's kind of a busy time going up there and hammering, but I'm sitting up here listening with my eyes closed and thinking of what Jesus went through for me. Can you hear it? Can you hear the spikes being driven? Wow. Let's pray over the elements before we take communion. Lord, we gather together at your table. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, thank you, God, for dying on the cross for us and shedding your blood. And Lord, I pray that you just bless these elements tonight. May we give you praise and glory for everything for which you did for us, for the plan of salvation. And God, thank you. Thank you for sending your one and only Son to be our sacrifice. Thank you, Lord. Amen. In 1 Corinthians, it says, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Take, eat, and be thankful. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." And he is coming again. Amen?
Amen.
Take, drink, and be thankful. Thank you, Lord, that by your Spirit we're all one in Christ. Thank you, God, that it wasn't just the death on Good Friday, but it was the resurrection that we're looking forward to. Today's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Amen. Let's stand together. We can compose ourselves. Let's stand together and sing the old rugged cross.
And I love.
on this Good Friday. And look, just Sunday morning, Jesus Christ will rise again. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And also meet us out on Sunday morning at La Casa Ramada, and we'll celebrate Jesus' resurrection morning. Amen? You are dismissed.